this presentation to my Aunt Gladys and my Uncle William. My Aunt Gladys just passed away last year, and it doesn't seem quite the same without her. And I also want to dedicate this presentation to Nicole. Nicole just passed away 2 weeks ago, and she was really looking forward to finding out more about her family. She wasn't even 50 yet. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some objectives. We're going to review some family photos. I'll give you some historical perspective on the highs, Chicago Defender research, and then how to research your own family, or if you're helping someone, how they can do research with Chicago Defender, okay? Okay, so it was Saturday, July 26th. My cousin Lori, her son Jeremy, and I went to her parents' house outside Chicago to celebrate her father's birthday. I hadn't seen Uncle William or my father's sister, Aunt Gladys, in a couple of months, and while there, the conversation turned toward the Sand Creek Boyd family reunion here in Starkville. While we were chatting, I asked them if I could borrow some of their family photos for a presentation, and Uncle William went downstairs and came back with a white, oversized box of loose photos. I was tempted to look at them then and there, but I didn't. I waited until I got back home. Hours later, I returned home and put the big box on the kitchen table. I grabbed a handful of photos and scrutinized them one by one, looking for that something special. Many of them were Kodak images, date stamped for posterity, from the 1960s and 70s. Others were Kodak images from the 1950s. I'm not sure why Lori is cuddling the dog instead of her brother, but that's another question. And this is at my grandfather's farm in Sand Creek, which is now Clayton Village. It's been renamed after E.P. Clayton, who I think was a professor here at Mississippi State. So you have my Aunt Charlie Ann, her beau at the time, Shane Curry, Aunt Gladys, and of course, Uncle William on his car. And underneath Granddaddy's pecan tree. Some more pictures of Uncle William and his sister Marvell over there in New Light. Another picture, this one is I think in front of the church, the New Light Church. And we've got some information on the back. So we have Mr. and Mrs. James McDowell, must be Marvell's husband of Starkville. And then we have Mr. and Mrs. Dallas West, also Starkville, and it says Alvin L. there, Route 3. And then I'm not sure about this address at the bottom, the 326 Walnut Street. And of course, we've got Uncle William's sister and his father. And then we have these unknown photos. So this is the first one. Got another one. And we've got a clue on the back of that one, the High Family of Aberdeen. And then my favorite one of all. So, upon viewing one of the photos, I caught my breath. I was horrified and thrilled at the same time. The 4x6 photo was in awful condition, but I was absolutely captivated by the tableau. Five well-dressed men standing in front of a store and another man off to the side, curiously looking at the photographer from his horse and buggy carriage. On top of the store was a shingle that read, Judge P. H. I. something, fancy grocer. The next day, with the original in hand, along with an 8.5x11 enlargement, I went back to my cousin's house and grilled her. This is Lori I'm talking about. Who is Judge P. High? And her response was, I don't know. Was this picture taken in Starkville or Aberdeen? I don't know. When was this picture taken? I don't know. Well, who gave this picture to Uncle William? I don't know. After hearing nothing but I don't knows, I exploded. I said, Lori, you have a gold mine here and don't even know it. So that's how I was introduced to the High family. Now, when I was doing research, the first thing I wanted to look at was the Bureau of Land Management as far as the land patents here in Mississippi. And I came across a Mark Mitchell High, and it looks like he came from Pickens County, Alabama, which is right across the border, and where he had 8 patents as early as 1835. And it looks like he came to Mississippi about 1856 and acquired another 6 patents. So what you can see over there, so we've got Octibaha, we've got Lowndes, and then we've got Pickens County right on the other side. And if you're wondering where the land was, my family was over there in B2 here, and the Highs are over here in B4. So this is what I know about Uncle William's great-great-grandmother, Mahala High. So I actually found her just a couple of months ago on a will of Mark Mitchell High's uncle. She's being willed to his cousin. So I'm not sure at what point the ownership had transferred, but I can see that she's got three sons by an unknown father. I've got Henry High, Perry High, and Albert, along with their wives. So Perry married in 1865. His older brother married in 1870, and his sister Jane married in 1869. So when I did the research in this census, I've got, this is the neighborhood, so dwelling 64, 65, and 66. I've got Perry with his wife Mary Ellen, and a couple of the children, Eli, Mary Jane, and John W. In dwelling 65, I've got Henry and Sally. And of course, in dwelling 66, I have Albert Burton and Jane High, along with the child, and then also Mahala High, who's listed as domestic servant. And just so you know, Tammy, can you stand up for a second? Tammy is a double high. She is not only the great-granddaughter of Albert and Jane, but she's also the granddaughter, the great-granddaughter of Eli. Thank you, Tim. So this is July 28, 1870. You know, it's not often that we catch people twice on one census, but this is what happened. I've got Mahala with her daughter on July 28th. 2 days before, she's in her own home, dwelling number 17, and she's listed as a black woman keeping house. And I don't know if you noticed, but on the census, her children are listed as mulattoes, mixed race, okay? So she's in dwelling 16, and we have Mark Mitchell High in dwelling 16 right next door. So what I wanted to find out, I really wanted to find out if he would be listed on any death certificate for Perry or Jane or Henry. So this is the 1880 census, so I want to continue to do research. And as you know, when you're doing the research, you're starting with yourself and working your way back. But if I had done that, this would be 2 hours. So I had to cut some things somewhere. So in 1880, of course, I've got Henry, and in his household, you have Mahala, and you've got a grandmother, Rose McDaniel. Now, what I understand is that Mark Mitchell High's first wife was a Clara McDaniel. I also have Perry High with his wife, Mary Ellen, and children, Elaine, Mary Jane, John W. again, and then a couple more children, Ida and Andrew. So in addition, there's the 1885 and 1878 Educational Children's List that are available for Ottawa County, and I did find Perry High on the 1885 listing with his children, Eli, Mary Jane, this time it says John H., but I really think that's a W. Particularly as they're part of the Methodist Church, I think that might be John Wesley. I'm still researching that one. And then J.P., Ida, and Andrew again. And of course, I came across the Freedmen Bureau's reports several years ago at the National Archives, and there are about 143 listings of cases here for Oktibbeha County, and I found a couple for the Highs. So we've got Perry High, who's filed a complaint against a Dr. S. Cooper, Samuel Cooper, and it says fraud in division of crop. That's October 1865. It says notified to settle the case by arbitration, appear October 19, 1865 to answer complaint. October 19th, neither party appeared. Well, it looks like there's still an issue because now Mama's filed. So Mama's really mad here. So she's filed, again, unfair division of crop. And again, it says set for trial November 9th. November 9th, defendant appeared and stated that the matter had been settled. Complainant not appearing, case postponed indefinitely. So I've got a little bit more information. So I'm going to focus in on this third and fourth group. So we've got Eli, we've got Mary Jane, John, Judge, Ida, Andrew, and a couple more children, Cora, Eleanor, Doc, and Vernanda. And this is Uncle William's line here, John, and then these are his children. Okay, so that's what we'll be talking about. So 1910, of course, I'm thinking about this photo again, and I'm looking in Perry High's household, and I don't see Judge. But I do see a couple of grandchildren that are listed, who are Ellen McEwen and Magruder High. That's Uncle William's father. But when I do find Judge, I find him in Aberdeen with his sister and brother-in-law, along with their two children, along with a younger sister. So down here, I know you can't read this, but I'm going to blow this up here. And so for Sylvester's profession, we have a fireman, locomotive as the profession, and then we have a retail merchant, groceries, for Judge High. So remember that photo that we had? Okay. So now we can identify that, and I have been to Aberdeen. I did not locate exactly where it was, so that is on my to-do list, and I think I went to Aberdeen back in 2009. So in 1920, I have Judge back in Altoona County. His mom, Ellen, has passed away in 1926 in Kiney. It looks like they're newly married. And then in the neighborhood here, we also have Eli and Anna, his wife, children, Jenny, Tammy's grandmother, Letha, Theodore, Foley, and Emery. And then we also have Ellen, who's still alive in 1920, Doc, Bernanda, and Magruder, Uncle William's father, and then we have Judge and Carrie living with his mother and some siblings. And then also we have Henry, who's still alive in 1920 as well, along with his daughter and son-in-law, Oscar and Mahala McKay, Doretha, Galitha, and a couple more children, one of them named after Henry. 1930, we've got Judge in Webster County, along with four children, Juanita, Jerlene, Virgie, and Perry Howard High. I don't know if you remember, but on that Educal Children's list, it said P.H. High. So I'm thinking that might be Perry Howard, right? So now, back to the photo. So I met Nicole about a year ago at my aunt's funeral, and she said, oh yeah, that's Lillian. This is my grandmother, my other grandmother. And then, thanks to Tammy, I met Tammy by phone, and then I came down and we got together. And so you look at Uncle William's picture, this is Tammy's picture. So we've got Doc High. Then this is Uncle William's picture on the left, Eli in his cabbage patch, the picture that Tammy has with the watermelons. And can you see the kitty cat here? Thank you, Tammy. And then Uncle William's picture here that you didn't know, well, these are Tammy's grandmother and father. Tammy's grandmother here. Not sure who these are, but maybe we can work on them too. And then we have this mystery photo that I still don't know who they are, but to me he looks like a high. I have not identified him yet, but maybe one day. This one's still a mystery to me, and of course that one is still a mystery. But we've got, and I'm still wondering, has anybody seen these numbers in these photos before? What is it? That's what I'm going to ask you. I don't know. I'm curious about that. And of course, we have Judges, which is no longer a mystery. So now, a couple years ago, I was doing some scanning at my aunt's house, who lives in town, O.C. Burks. And I knew my scanner, so I was going to go to Office Depot. Well, I made a wrong turn, and I saw this sign. I said, I am not going to Aberdeen. Came across another sign. I am not going to Aberdeen. I came across this sign. I said, I am not going to Aberdeen. Yes, I'm going to Aberdeen. So when I went to Aberdeen, I was taking some photos, and behind this wall here is a barbershop. And a guy saw me taking photos, and he said, are you a journalist? I said, no, I'm just doing some research in town. So he invited me into the barbershop. I didn't know these people. There's three people in the barbershop. We must have talked for an hour and a half. And he kept saying, you know, I really got to go. I said, I know, me too. And we kept talking. We kept talking. The third time around, he says, well, let me take you on a tour of the downtown area. So he takes me to every single merchant up and down Main Street. He He even introduces me to the alderman and I think the mayor of Aberdeen there. Really nice. And I'm really mad because at this time, this was Christmas time, and they had this, had Aberdeen so beautifully decorated. I wish I had a camera. I'm so mad at myself. But so that was my introduction to Aberdeen, and I can't wait to get back. And this is what I found in the courthouse. If I'm not mistaken, I think this is the courthouse here. So in 2009, you know, I only started research in 2006, but I was a genealogist. I must have gone to every conference that I possibly could. And when I was at this one here, the National Archives Civil War Symposium, I actually met Dr. John Marslick and his wife Jeannie. So I said, oh my gosh. I said, I have to talk to you. And I don't think he had the grand papers here yet, but he had been talking to me about them. But in addition, I had gone to this one here, the International Black Genealogy Summit, and everybody kept talking about this presentation right here, Finding and Using African-American Newspapers by Tim Pennant. Now, Tim Pennant's a local, he's now living in North Carolina, but at the time he was living in Illinois, and then this one as well. And I said, well, what do I care about these papers, especially as a Chicago Defender? My people are in Mississippi. But the Chicago Defender is actually a national paper that would have gone from New York to Wyoming. There are even mentions of Canada people there. So I was shocked. So of course I said, okay, I need to know more about these black newspapers, and in particular my home one, which would be the Chicago Defender. And that's been around since 1905. Microfilm here in Mississippi State is available, but it starts in 1909 and goes through 2017, if I'm not mistaken, Elizabeth. So a lot of good information. So when I first did this presentation back in 2010, I had found about 40 social columns about the Hyde's. I'm now up to 120. And this is just focusing in on Perry Hyde's family, not even focusing in on Henry or James' family. So I expect to find many more when I do this. So let me just show you what this is all about. So this is Tim and my mentor, Janice Forte, and of course, Tim's book, chock full of information. And then, so I want to do a comparison. For Starkville newspapers, black people are not typically listed unless, you know, for front pages like now, whatever leads, leads, you know, whatever bleeds, leads. So, you know, you've got a double hanging here in Starkville of Henry Seals and Peter Bowen. The other thing that I found typically in the mainstream newspapers is you might have the aunts and uncles, you know, former slaves that might be listed as having passed away, or you might have something in jail. But when you look at the black newspapers, you get a totally different feel for it. And I just want to read a paragraph from the Black Press by the late Verlinger. And he says, we didn't exist in other papers. We were neither born, we didn't get married, we didn't die. We didn't fight in any wars. We never participated in anything of scientific achievement. We were truly invisible unless we committed a crime. Hence, you saw what I mean. And in the black press, the Negro press, we did get married. They showed our babies being born. They showed us graduating. They showed our PhDs. So I'm just going to show you what I mean here. So in addition to the Chicago Defender, the other major black newspapers are the Atlanta Daily World, the Baltimore Afro-American, the Cleveland Column Post, the Los Angeles Sentinel, the New York Amsterdam News, Norfolk Journal and Guide, Philadelphia Tribune, and the Pittsburgh Courier. Full of information. I've also find information on my family in the Pittsburgh Courier as well. So this is John Robert Zangstead. He graduated in 1899 from Chicago Kent College of Law in Chicago. And in 1905, he founded the paper. So this is the first of many columns that I found. And the first one here is 1915. I've got Mr. Doc High in town to spend a few weeks in Aberdeen there. We are all glad to have him. September 1915, he's still around. The first bachelor party given by Mr. Dick High, and you will come across typos in many of these papers, was the first of the season. Everyone present stated an enjoyable time, games, whist, and other amusements. Cake, wine, ice cream were the refreshments of the evening. So remember that photo? Can anybody see that? Those particularly in the first row? What does that say? Doc. That's Doc. Don't you love that outfit that she's wearing? I would wear that today. It's gorgeous. Okay, so the next one here, Mr. John Hyde. Carpenter has been called to Mugden, Mississippi on an extra job. Well, we know that's not Mugden, that's another typo, Mugden, right? So in fact, I actually found an IC Illinois Central Railroad, and they had a list of towns and the stops all between, and that's where I found that. In addition, we've got Mrs. Dave Bradford, returned home last week after one good week in Stafford, Alabama. Mr. George Goodwin, the upstairs barber, made quite a change when he bought Levin's Barbershop last Monday. Mr. J.P. Hyde, better known as the Medicine Man, has sold many herbs and tablets and started and has orders for many more. And then the editor goes on a rant. When a person lives to the age of 84 and then is taken sick, we know without being told that this person needs help, and more especially when they have no relatives to see after them. And then he continues on his rant. He's not happy about somebody. We don't know who he's talking about yet. So that was Judge's story. That's the medicine man that they're talking about. Now, what I didn't show here, can you see this crate, those of you in the front? Can you see what that says? If not Coca-Cola. Can you see the bananas here? Can you see the portrait back here inside the store? And it looks like we might have some coconuts over here, and maybe some milk bottles here. Okay, and then the next one, and this is what you're looking at. So when you look at the Chicago Defender, particularly the later articles, and when I say late, I mean 1920s, you'll have a Mississippi section, a Georgia section, an Alabama section, Ohio, Illinois, et cetera, Canada. So I'm in the Mississippi section right now. And even though up here it says Editor Wilson pays Abbeville a visit, we know we're talking about Aberdeen because it says right here. And it says Aberdeen, January 7, 1916. And down here it says, Editor Lott of Mound Bayou, Mississippi was in the city last week in behalf of his paper, the Mound Bayou Dispatch. While here, he appointed Mrs. Katie L. High, agent, and Mr. Doc High, travel correspondent. So they're going to be the ones who are responsible for getting news about people in Aberdeen. Katie Hyde would be Uncle William's grandmother. They always referred to her as Sister Katie. They weren't allowed to call her grandma. In addition to this one down here, it says here, after spending a happy week with her cousins, Mr. and Mrs. Sylvester Barnes, Mrs. Polly Strode of Memphis, Tennessee, left for Sturgis. Well, who's in Sturgis? Over there in Beat 4. That's where the rest of the highs are. And then we have Reverend J.M. March of West Point and Miss Dixie Bell of Holly Springs were the guests of Mrs. Ida Barnes. Well, J.M. March married another high sister, Elnora. So there we have Doc again. And then the following week, we've got another mention that says, Editor Lott of Mound Bayou and Mr. Doc Hyde of West Point, Mississippi, left for Amory, where they will spend a week in the interest of their paper. So you know I've got a homework assignment. I need to find this Mound Bayou Dispatch newspaper and see if I can get more information. Then it also says, Editor Wilson of Oklahoma is expected to join them. Okay, and we have another mention here. Mr. and Mrs. Sylvester Barnes have returned from High, Mississippi after spending a week with Mrs. Barnes' parents, Mr. and Mrs. Perry High. Mrs. Lee Knox and children who spent the last 2 weeks with relatives in New Orleans returned home Wednesday. So a couple of observations. There was once a High, Mississippi, and Perry High is still alive in 1916. So when did Mississippi require death certificates? Anybody know? Or birth certificates.
1920.
Exactly. So I should be able to get a death certificate. However, I have not had any success yet. I think that first reel is a bad batch. It's hard to look at. Okay? Over here, that Lee McComb's wife, that who gone to New Orleans, it says, Brakeman on the IC between Aberdeen and Duran was taken sick while out on the road last week. And is confined to his bed for several days. Over here, you've got information about Sylvester. So Sylvester Barnes, fireman on the IC between Aberdeen and Durant, so you know he's a co-worker, was injured in a wreck near Starkville a few days ago, is up but not able to work. So of course, and then you've got to mention down here, the secret marriage of Miss Lizzie Buckingham to Mr. William Page of Birmingham Monday night at the Parsonage was certainly a surprise to many friends. I believe Lizzie Buckingham is related to DeWitt Augustus Buckingham, who was a doctor here decades ago. And then we've got another one here. We've got Aberdeen, 1916. An enjoyable affair on Friday, March 24th, the well-planned party given by Mrs. Sylvester Barnes in honor of her daughter, Mary Ellen, this being her ninth birthday. So if birth certificates didn't start until 1912, I know I've got her birthday as March 24th, 1907, and she's 9 years old. This gives me a lot of information. In addition, you've got a duet by Miss Laura Buchanan and Master G. Wood of Durand, a solo by Mrs. Vernanda Cook of High, Mississippi. So I know we've got another relative there. And again, we've got Mrs. John Barnes, Ida Barnes of the city, is here visiting Mr. and Mrs. John Hyatt, other relatives. And notice, it's saying that she's from Canton. So now, before the 1930 census, where I actually found her in Canton, I knew she's in Canton as early as 1929. And then down here, I've got John Hyatt is improving nicely. So I know at some point he had been sick, okay? I've got other ones. Parents welcome their daughters home from various schools. Mrs. Fanny Coleman and Mary Barnes from Clark University. This is the 1920s. She's going to college. How often does that happen? And Mrs. Lillian Stowell and brother Johnny High will leave for St. Louis on Sunday. So now I've got another home assignment. Who's in St. Louis? I need to find this out. But remember Lillian? This one here. And then we have Dr. F.D. Baines was brought home from Clarksville, Tennessee last week with an injured arm and back. He was seriously hurt by a fall through a railroad trestle, but is resting fine at home. Dr. Baines is a prominent dentist in Clarksville. I want you to remember that name. Canton, Mississippi, 1929. Mrs. Ida Barnes left Friday for Aberdeen to visit her daughter, Miss Fernanda Barnes, who is teaching in that city. Fernanda would also go to Clark University. Imagine this. This is off of a fireman's salary that he's able to put his two daughters through college in Mississippi in the 1920s. This is phenomenal. Down here we have, starting here, Ms. Fernanda High, formerly of Aberdeen, Mississippi, and Dr. Fred D. Bays of Nashville were quietly married Tuesday evening by Reverend Monell, pastor of the Amy Church. Dr. and Mrs. Bays will make their home with her sister and brother-in-law, Mr. and Mrs. Sylvester Barnes. So if I was looking for a marriage record, I know exactly what time frame. I'm looking at January 30th, when they should have been married in the home, about? This is amazing. And it even tells me where they're living, on Walnut Street. In addition to the social columns, you will find lots and lots of ads. That's how they pay for the paper. So this particular one here, Doc High, representative of the Clyde Collins Chemical Company of Memphis, Tennessee, say that three times fast, has returned after visiting Starkville, Ackerman, Choctaw County, and Sturgeon. So we've got a mention here about agents wanted for the Clyde Collins Chemical Company. Got another ad here. Let me read this one to you. So it says here, free, large, full size, 25-cent can of coconut oil, white, lucky hair dressing, free. You pay shipping and costs only. Only one to a customer, see coupon below. LaClyde Lucky Hair Dressing will straighten smooth without use of a comb. Here's your chance to have beautiful, glossy, silky hair overnight so you can arrange it in the latest child. See coupon below. Agent's free sample. We want an agent in every community to sell our complete line of toilet articles, medicines, and household necessities. Every item guaranteed, none better. Some of our agents, including women, make as much as 100 a month. With a little effort, you too can engage in this pleasant, profitable pastime. No experience necessary. Use the coupon. Do it now. Tear out a mail with your name and address. So how many of you think Doc is using his own product? I love a salesman with some integrity. He's got a bunch of that stuff in his hair. Here's another one. Mrs. Sadie Overton and Marion Cook, both of Greenville, are visiting in our city. Miss Cook is the guest of her aunt, Ida Barnes, and Miss Over, and again, another typo, the guest of Dr. and Mrs. T.E. Bowman. Mrs. Ida Barnes, many friends will regret to know that she is sick. So again, I've got to do some research in Greenville. These are the most traveling folks that I know of. Here's another one, and this one blew me away. I think this is the precursor to the same-sex wedding here in Mississippi. A manless wedding was given at the AME Church. Miss Louise Bell Bride and Miss Elkin Groom. Walter Coleman sang, Mrs. Kathleen Johnson played, and Doc High did magic tricks. A reception was given at the bride's home immediately after the wedding. So what was my next homework assignment? I know I looked them on the 1940 census, right? Can't find them anywhere. So when I get to Aberdeen, that's the first thing I'm going to look for. It's kind of marriage record here. Yes, 1931, Mississippi.
We used to have womanless weddings to raise money. They were piloting events.
Oh, but this is a reception. Was there a reception too?
Yeah.
Or what?
Well, it was all part of it.
Okay.
It was like a theater experience.
Okay. Yeah, this would be a theater experience, I think. Especially 1931, right? Because I have seen some manless weddings. Some womanless weddings too listed. So now this one here is for Starkville. Mrs. Josie Lee Skinner entertained the club at her home. There were 34 present. The meeting was opened by Mrs. Seamy Hardy. Homer Gibson was the guest of Miss Ruby Hall at West Point. Fred Lanady is sick. Send your news to Eugene Hawkins. So a couple of things. You know that Eugene Hawkins is the correspondent for Starkville. But then there's nothing in about the Highs. But does anybody recognize any of these names? I bet you'd like to, huh? If you're doing research. This one here is from Ackerman, and I'm even that one. I can't read that one. So this one says again nothing about the high school. There's an extension class, and it says Mrs. G. E. Perriman, agent of Choctaw County, and Mayor Walter Lane and A. R. Harold motor to Starkville every 2 weeks, taking the extension class. Spanish, English, and education. Isn't that amazing? This one is from December 1931, Aberdeen. And it says here, the fifth grade honor roll for the high school is William Gray, spelling, arithmetic, and history, Maggie Owens, reading geography and English, John Covington, perk attendance, and Ms. Dora Hammer, teacher. So we've got, we also have Doc, who's visiting in Starkville, and I suspect he's probably visiting Eli. So we've got Eli and his wife Anna, Jenny, Letha, Theodore, Goley, and Emery. And then we've got this one here from 1932. Mr. Whitting was a delegate from the Ashbury ME Church to the Hattiesburg Conference, which met December 31st. We are pleased to have Reverend J.W. Isabel returned to Canton. Mrs. Mary Ellen Johnson and husband of Alcorn visited her parents, Mr. and Mrs. Sylvester Barnes, Miss Cleo Davenport at Alcorn visited her Fernanda Barnes. So again, I've got to look at Alcorn now if I'm looking for these hives. As I said, they're all over the place. And then down here, you've got this Friendly Five motored to Jackson Christmas Day. I'm not sure what the Friendly Five, but you know the hives were part of this, right? This is the second son, High Barnes. And they were going all over the place as well. I'm not sure if they had if this was an actual group where they played or what, or was it just the name of their club? But I've got, again, I've got lots of homework that I still need to do. And then I have this one here, and again, it's for Starkville. Nothing about the Hive, but it's interesting. Mrs. Emma Agnew organized a whist club, which met every Tuesday night. The members are Walter Yates, Brister Steets, P.A. Darley, Harry Fields, Jesse Miner, L. Johnson, Tommy Curry, and Eckford Alexander. How many Eckfords do you think there are in Starkville here, named after Dr. Eckford, way back when? There are a bunch of them. And then we have Mr. and Mrs. John Taylor, Mortimer, Earl, Arkansas, Kelly Hayes, attended the fair in Macon, Jim and Charles McCautry from Denver, Colorado, are visiting, they're visiting in the home of Richard Hunter. This is 1932, and the McCautrys are all traveled from Colorado back to Mississippi. This is amazing. And then we have, let's see, send your news to Eugene Hawkins for the Chicago Defender, who's still a correspondent, and then we see Mrs. Florence Bolden has opened a cafe. And then this one here from 1932 in Aberdeen. And it says, Miss Louise Bell has, as dinner guests, Mrs. Zoe Lloyd and baby. And then it talks about some other people. And then further down, we're looking at right here. It says that Sunday afternoon, a debate was at the St. Paul M.E. Church. Walter Corman was chairman. The question was, is prohibition a failure? The debaters were Mace Muir, Daniel Treese, Robert Bork, Doc High, and Henry Berry. The judges were Ms. Vashti Jones, Mace Muir, Steve Gilbert, Hugh Gray. The points were 4-4. We don't get that kind of information even in the Starkville papers. I love this. We're almost done here. Not too much longer here. And so we have Ms. Polycroft was hostess to a surprise party, a four-course dinner, and of course, where do we see? We've got Doc High. Of course he's going to be there. He's hooked up with the right people. And then we have down here, we've got a notice that Alora Whitney died Friday morning after a long illness. She leaves a widow of Gold Whitney, two children, John Wesley and Cynthia. We also have a mention of another funeral. Maybe not. Let's see here. Mr. and Mrs. Charles Monroe of Columbia, of Columbus, but Sunday here. Mrs. Marion, can't read that, and daughter spent the week in Columbus. All kinds of information. If you're looking for your family, and don't just focus in on your immediate town, you've got to take a look at the county maps and look around at the surrounding cities as well. They traveled just like we did. I think they must have traveled even more, it sounds like. And of course, here we've got Doc High of Aberdeen was the recent guest of his brother, Judge High. So before the 1940 census even comes out, I know where he is. This is 1935 and he's in Kosciuszko. So, cities of focus, and I need to add on here Alcorn too. So Starkville, Aberdeen, Canton, Ackerman, Sturgis, Alcorn, Kosciuszko, Greenville is what I need to add on there. So, this is one of the unusual ones. The Buck Billiken Club, which is a parade that's held in Chicago every second Saturday in August, I believe. But this one is saying, Dear Bud, I received my Buckman card. I am very proud of Billiken. I want boys and girls from 13 to 18 to write me. Every time I put on my coat, I look at my button and I think about the Buck Billiken Club. And notice, this is Geraldine High, Judge's daughter, 1942, with an address. And so when I looked at the Wikipedia page, it says the Buck Billiken Club was formed as a social club and part of the Defender Junior, the children's page in the newspaper to encourage reading, appropriate social conduct, and involvement in the community. And we've got this one down here. Sylvester Barnes of Georgia State College is assistant principal. Like I said, Sylvester and I were able to put the kids through college in the 1920s and 30s. And this, of course, is during World War II. And look at what we've got. T.J. Huddleston, owner of the Century Burial Association, purchased $1,000 worth of bonds for the Afro-American sons and daughters. Mr. and Mrs. Judge P. High and granddaughter Belva Ann are visiting relatives in Kansas City. So So when the 1950 comes up, I know where other people actually where they are now, from the 1940. But so I also have another generation. I have a first granddaughter. I have a second granddaughter, Joyce Marie. Her parents are Mr. and Mrs. Woodrow Say. So now I just have to figure out which daughter this is for. I don't think it's for Geraldine. She's still writing. She's still part of that blood building. So I'm looking at either Virgie or Juanita as being the mother of Joyce Marie. Oh no, I'm so sad. She's grown up so fast. Mr. and Mrs. Judge P. High announced the marriage of their daughter Geraldine to John Roby. Roby is the son of Mrs. Molly Roby. He served 2 years, 2 months, 7 days as a technical sergeant in the Philippine Islands, and their address. Mr. and Mrs. Judge High attended the funeral of their sister-in-law, Mrs. Anna High, at New Light Church. That's Eli's mom. That's Tammy's great-grandmother. Couple more here. George Holland, recent visitor of his sisters, Mrs. Judge P. High and Mrs. B. H. should be Ashford, I apologize. And then we have Mr. and Mrs. John Roby are the parents of a baby girl, Jean Carroll. So we've got three baby daughters for Judge. And in addition, I now know Connie's last name, who's the wife of that woman, as a last name. Talk some more ads. Aspirin and laxatives. And this is 1956, remember? We saw in 1950, he was doing his herbs and medicine. And then this is the last one. Mrs. Lillian Thomas and little daughter Sheila of Edmonton, Alberta are visiting her parents, Mr. and Mrs. William Magruder High of New Light Community. So that's Lillian, remember? This is Lillian, Uncle William's father. But what in the world is she doing in Edmonton? He's playing for the Canadian League. You may recognize him. You know, he was a coach for that other Mississippi school. We won't talk about that. So, like I said, when you do your research, you really got to know your family trees. You got to know who married. And then, know your counties. Look at the state map. And look at the cities surrounding. And look at the ones that are just too far away. Know your surnames. Not just your immediate family, but your in-laws, your neighbors, and your family friends. Know who married whom. Follow the clues and look for the vital statistics before they were mandated in Mississippi. And of course, you've got to create your homework list. Any questions? I want to thank you for your time. I hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah.